What worries you the most about the MIF, men?
Pardon?
What worries you the most about this fund?
So the first is, the concept is very muddled. And the bias is for transferring resources to a corporation which has a very muddled concept. So there is going to be a cost for BSP and for the other government financial institutions. My biggest worry is this. Remember that this is one a priority of the administration, and this administration has spent a lot of political capital to push for Maharlika. And this might be a preview of how the administration, particularly the economic team, will perform for the next 5 years. A lot of political capital to be wasted for an issue that is non-essential.
Can you expound on that? If that's your biggest worry, where's the Filipino people in all of that, in the scenario that you just painted?
That means that the resources we have and our fiscal space right now is fragile in light of the heavy borrowing, understandably done during the period of the pandemic, and we're still in the pandemic period. But given the fragile fiscal space, the resources we have should be used wisely. For example, we need more resources for health. In fact, there are priority bills to strengthen pandemic resiliency and to improve our universal health care. But these bills can be endangered might be endangered because of lack of funding. The funding can come from the available resources that we have, but such resources will be diverted to other projects or programs like Maharlika. So the Filipino people will lose there. It's a question of resources that can have a bigger impact on development being diverted to a fund that is supposed to grow such resources. But that is not the function of a government. The way for government to increase its resources principally is to raise revenues, not to engage in commercial or market activities.
Especially when we're just coming from a pandemic and resources that you speak of are needed now and not later on after the funds have been grown by the MIF. Because that's also one of the criticisms is that, you know, when you put it into that fund, it's not instantaneous. This development growth that they're promising, it's not going to happen overnight. But the problems that we're having are current. It's being experienced right now as we speak. Go ahead.
Yes, spot on. I agree with you.
So, but here's the thing. If everything that you're saying is true and all of these concerns of yours are well-founded, why would you think the economic managers would risk their reputation as they go on and give their full support to this fund?
That also baffles me. And that question, I guess, has to be addressed to our economic team. Remember that their colleagues in the profession, in the academe, have come out against Maharlika. Very firm statements from the School of Economics, from other economists, from other institutions. So it's baffling why the economic team will go along with Maharlika. There is a sound concept for Maharlika, but as we have said, as others have said, we can use excess funds to grow these excess funds. But what is happening now, using available resources for Maharlika, which is unsound.
Hmm. Because those resources are needed somewhere else. And
yes,
they're
for,
not needed to
for
be
the capital, for agriculture, for development in general.
Mm.
Furthermore,
yeah,
Maharlika, the funds of Maharlika said to be invested in some corporations or in some sectors that will earn high rates of return. Again, this is problematic because why will government involve itself in sectors that are already earning high rates of return? To return to one essential function of government, it can participate in the economy when there is market failure or when government wants to create market. These sectors in energy, in infrastructure, mm. would yield high returns. Mm-hmm. And so investments will be coming in. No need for government to meddle when there is already a market.
Mm-hmm.
Another problem there is because government will be involved in investing in the domestic economy, in infra, in energy, even in real estate, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
How will government choose the particular sectors or the particular companies that is ripe for corruption, that is ripe for cronyism?
Final question for you, man, before we let you go. What to you would be the true test for the people to know whether or not the MIF is all that it promises to be?
Right now, the bill will be signed into law, and the one option will be the Supreme Court. But for the Supreme Court to make a good decision here, we have to look at the legal implications. And this is going to be a challenge because the Maharlika decision is a policy, and we have to determine whether such policy violates constitutional provisions. Unfortunately, I'm not the expert here, mm-hmm. but that is one option. But since, as I said, Maharlika is a preview of what economic policy and economic direction will be for the next 5 years, our people should become more vigilant in making government, the administration, accountable. We cannot afford such kind of a policy. We lost 1 year in trying to address what the main bottlenecks are. We have problems in relation to high prices, in relation to food shortage, in relation to a narrowing of fiscal space, in relation to energy. These are the issues which I hope the administration will focus on. And it's the public's task to flag the administration and inform the administration that our priorities are being neglected.
Man Santa Ana, their coordinator of the group Action for Economic Reforms. Thanks again for joining us today, man. Nice to see you again. Take care.